Hey family, we can invite anybody that would like to come into the viewing room and we're going to have a family prayer.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today, whether in person or on the broadcast. I don't see any cameras, so maybe we're not broadcasting. I don't know. Oh, there's one right there. We gather today with heavy hearts, not just for the passing of my mom, but we're also mindful of the Gallen family and the passing of Ginny Gallen, the mother of Madison, and the mother-in-law to Kesley Rogers Gallen, and our hearts are with the Gallens today. My name is Patrick Lee. I'm the youngest son of Merrill and Palma Lee, better known as Buzz and Poss, or Puss and Boz, as some have called them. My brother Mike and my sister Deanne asked if I would conduct our service today, and it's an honor to do so. We'll begin by singing a congregational hymn, A Child's Prayer. I think my niece, Kristen, my mom's granddaughter-in-law, will conduct the music. And I think, Sophie, are you playing? Chase, my mom's great-grandson, will play the piano. You'll notice from the program that all the songs are primary songs. You think you've been in your church calling for a long time. My mom served in the primary for 25 consecutive years. She loved little children, and the primary songs today are a tribute to her. Following the hymn, my brother-in-law, Ron Rogers, will offer the invocation.
Our Father in heaven, we come before thee this morning to celebrate the life and the death of Palma Lee. We are so grateful for all of those who have cared for her during this final time for her on earth, for the family, the neighbors, the friends, the medical staff that watched over her. We are so very grateful for our Savior, for his atonement, for the assurance that he has made possible for us to be resurrected and reunite our spirit and our body. We are also very grateful for the temples that thou hast built, that we can take out our endowments and make covenants with thee, that we get the possibility of returning, if we're faithful, to live with thee in life eternal. We want to thank thee for the other many blessings that we enjoy, and ask that thou be with us during these services, that we will feel the love and support from thee and from our Savior. We pray for these things and say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Ron. And thank you, Kristen and Chase, for the music. By the way, judging by the opening song, I'm wondering if everybody has the words to the hymns. They are printed on pieces of paper, so if you have them, if you don't have it, raise your hand, because we have a bunch. Okay, thank you. It was a beautiful song, nonetheless. About 2 years ago, well, almost exactly 2 years ago, many of us were in this exact same room to honor the passing of my dad. And at that time, my brother was conducting, and he made everyone stand and introduce themselves. I thought it was crazy, but now that I'm here, I think it's a pretty good idea. So, this is my wife, Shannon. Stand up, Shannon. And my daughter, Mackenzie. And now I would like Deanne to introduce all of the Ron and Deanne Rogers family. When you're done, Mike, would you introduce the Mike and Julie Lee family? And then I think you both know some people who are here that I don't, so please feel free to introduce them as well. That would be make it to temple marriage, is what you meant. Yes, please stand, because I... There we go. All right. Thank you. Anyway, they have a home here by us, and
Kid, then John, then Laura, and then my wife Kristen, my son Andrew, and his girlfriend Maddie, and Whitney, so we're being there.
And I'm John, this is my wife Courtney, and these are our kids, David and Poppy.
I'm Laura, my husband's mother, and then our kids, James, Olivia, the 10 of them.
Amanda, this is my husband Layton, and our four kids, Owen, Anna, Henry, and Charlie.
We also have friends here. Let's see, who is where? The Sorbers, Ken and Kristen Sorber, Elaine Ellis. And Glenn is here today too. I gotta control myself. The son lives in Lynchie, Courtney, Jay, and Jody. And we have Vicki and Daryl Smith. And over here, we have Daryl Christensen, her son Peter, and his wife Jenny, she was a Relief Society president. And Stephen Lee, our cousin.
And his wife Elaine. And his wife Elaine. Oh, where'd she go?
If you see her, let me know her.
Okay.
I think I have to mention Burke Jackson, this is Kristen. Okay, Burke and Don Jackson. Now, who am I doing that?
Sharon Jackson.
Oh, Sharon. No,
thank you. I think we got everyone. It's a good thing we didn't have 500 people here. So the program will go as outlined. I would like to point out a couple of things. The song, Sir, Will You, Sir, Have You Seen My Pony, will be introduced by Andrew Lee, my mom's oldest great-grandchild. And then after we sing the closing primary song, Families Can Be Together Forever, we won't have a closing prayer here. We will, everyone's invited to dismiss and head up to the East Lawn Cemetery, where my nephew Chris, my mom's oldest grandchild, will dedicate the grave, and that will be the end of our service. My mom and dad were sticklers for being on time and being done on time, so we're gonna try to be done on time in an hour so that they aren't seething in their graves. So as I said, almost exactly 2 years ago, we were here to honor my dad. Now, you'll recall, those of you who knew my dad, he was outspoken, he was gregarious, he wore his opinions and his emotions on his sleeve. You got unsolicited stories, hundreds of them, providing plenty of content for things like this. My mom was on the opposite end of the spectrum. She, not that she didn't have opinions, not that she didn't have emotions and things that she felt very strongly about, but she rarely, if ever, shared them. My mom was quiet, she was pleasant, she was generous, and she was gracious. I once asked my mom why it is that we never went to visit the graves of my grandparents, my grandpa and grandma Ball, her parents. And I'll never forget what she said. She said, well, I don't really need to, because they're not there. Those simple words have always stuck with me. My mom didn't need a lot of words to express her tremendous faith in God. My mom was also thrifty, very thrifty, and she never called attention to herself. She didn't like it. She would be very uncomfortable with all the attention today. In fact, I noticed as she laid there in the coffin, her lips were pursed just a little bit. And this reminds me of a look that she would have when she didn't like something. You know, it's a little bit of, I don't know, some little pursing of the lips that she didn't, so I can tell she probably doesn't like this going on today. I thought that I would give you five things that I learned from my mom. Number one, you don't need to buy new stuff all the time. Avoid unnecessary purchases and save your money for things you really need and you want. My mom lived by the adage, use it up, wear it out, make it do, or do without. The hundreds of garden tools and things that are ancient and blow dryers that were bought in the 1960s that are still exist in the house today are a testament to that. I think my mom was affected by being raised during the Great Depression, during a time of scarcity. And my mom's thriftiness was one of the primary reasons my parents were able to live for almost three decades after my dad retired. My mom did splurge occasionally, but never for herself. If there was splurging, it was almost always for her kids, or her grandkids, or someone that she loved. There were at least three times, however, I remember, well, my dad occasionally splurged on my mom. And I can remember at least three times when he came in with a brand new car. My dad's excitement would always be tempered, and I would say quashed, by my mom. And I can still hear her say, "Buzz, why did you buy that car? We don't need it." My mom was thrifty, sometimes to a fault. Number two, the second thing I learned from my mom, effective discipline doesn't have to be harsh discipline. It can be done by persuasion and kindness and example. An example of this that will forever be emblazoned in my head took place when I was in third grade. I remember that a note from the principal was sent home to my parents about me. Fortunately, my mom intercepted it before it got to my dad. And as my mom read over the description of her son's bad behavior, she began to cry. With tears flowing, she said to me, "Where have we gone wrong with you?" I don't remember what the consequences were, but I do remember two things about this circumstance. Just like Ralphie's mom in A Christmas Story, when my dad came home from work and asked how my day was at school, my mom expertly intervened and diverted his attention to something else, diffusing a potentially ugly situation for me. The second thing I remember is the anguish I felt from seeing my mom cry. That was punishment enough, and from that day forward, I vowed to clean up my act because I never wanted to see my mom cry again. The third thing I learned from my mom, always be hospitable when given the opportunity. People will remember your hospitality or lack thereof. Growing up in Downey, California, unlike you lucky children of Utah, I attended early morning seminary. Each morning after seminary and before school started, my friend Paul Richard and I would go to my house, where my mom always made us breakfast and offered us lots of choices. I can still hear my mom say, "Now, would you boys like some toast? Maybe some buttered toast. How about some toast with jam? Or maybe some cinnamon toast? How about some cheese toast?" To this day, when I see my friend Paul, he always asks me if I've had any cheese toast lately. Number four, the fourth thing I learned from my mom, enjoy life's simple pleasures, and it's okay to get dirty. Other than being at home with her family and having loved ones around her, there was no place my mom would rather have been than in the garden, pulling weeds, tending her plants, cultivating the good earth down on her hands and knees, and gently observing and making room for the inhabitants of the garden, the earthworms, the caterpillars, the beetles, the bees, the spiders. She loved them all. She never liked to work with long-handled tools like a hoe or a shovel. I think she worried that she might disturb these animals, these creatures, with those long-handled tools. She needed to be closer. She wanted her hands in the good earth. We had lots of gardenia plants at our house. Nothing reminds me of my mom more than the smell of gardenias. The other thing my mom was expert at was growing tomatoes. I don't think I have ever had a better tomato than the tomatoes my mom and dad grew, and I probably never will again. Every time I go to the grocery store, I'm sorely disappointed. My wife, Shannon, had a few thoughts as well that she asked me to read on this topic of enjoying the little things. Shannon says, I've always told people that I lucked out with my mother-in-law. You often hear stories about in-laws who meddle and cause problems, but not mine. Palma was always kind, loving, and supportive to me and my family for the past 36 years. About 6 or 7 years ago, my husband, daughter, and I took Buzz and Palma for a drive around town just to see some sights and get hamburgers and a milkshake. Buzz sat up front with my husband, my daughter, Mackenzie, and Palma and I were in the back seat. We got our hamburgers and milkshakes, and as we drove around town, the three of us were chatting and giggling like schoolgirls in the back seat of our car. Moments later, with French fries in her mouth, Palma began to laugh and said, "This is the most fun I've ever had." Maybe a sad commentary, I don't know. It's a memory that I cherish. Her family meant everything to her, and I mean everything. She was the greatest cheerleader and champion of her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Shannon says, I'm forever grateful for the lessons that I learned from my mother-in-law, that true happiness and contentment lies within the walls of our home. And lastly, the fifth thing I learned from my mom. You don't have to master the scriptures to be a master of the scriptures. I rarely ever saw my mom study the good word, and I don't think I ever heard my mom bear her testimony out loud. But I can't think of anyone more Christ-like than my mom. There was no one more kind, more gentle, more forgiving, more patient, or more willing to give someone the benefit of the doubt than my mom. For charity is the pure love of Christ, and if ye have not charity, ye are nothing. But whoso is found possessed of it at the last day, it shall be well with him. My mom was filled with charity. If you wonder how it is that my parents stayed married for 75 years, look no further than my mom. These were great lessons that my mom taught me, and these moments that she shared with me, I will always cherish. I'm grateful for the belief that I have and the assurance that I feel that was taught to me by my parents initially, that this separation from our loved ones upon death is a temporary thing, that we are children of a loving Heavenly Father who wants us all back to enjoy our family relationships for eternity. And I leave these things with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We will now follow the program as it's outlined. Music by the great-grandchildren.
was beautiful. Such talent in that family. Thank you. Well, growing up, our home wasn't always perfect, but for me, it was a home of kindness, warmth, and caring, a home of laughter, love, and sharing, a home of peace. And there was no other part of our home so dear as our mother. She made our house a home. There were always fresh flowers on the table. The cookie jar was always full. There was only one time during all my school years that she was not home when I got back from school, and she arrived only minutes later. We had a manicured yard, a beautiful garden, an immaculate and well-organized home, but she let us decorate our own rooms. She welcomed our friends and family. We had pool parties and barbecues. I even had a taffy pulling party. And we had pep rally painting parties at our house. My mom was the go-to mother for all of my girlfriends. When they needed advice, they'd always come to me and say, Deanne, would you ask your mom just what she would do? At 4 o'clock each weekday in the late 50s, she'd turn on American Bandstand and enjoy the rock and roll music of the day. On Sundays, the music of the Tabernacle Choir would fill the house. And in the car, she'd join Daddy in singing hymns or his beloved Western tunes. She was a scholar in school and a Jeopardy expert. If you wanted to know who the quarterback of the Seattle Seahawks is, or who won the Super Bowl last year, who scored the winning touchdown, if you wanted to know who won the Masters, or is it the Ryder Cup or the President's Cup this year, call Mom. She could fix anything. She was our own Martha Stewart. She could create anything, and her hands were always busy crocheting, digging in the dirt, making flower arrangements, or crafting. She looked beautiful and classy on Sunday, but she preferred being barefoot and wearing Bermuda shorts. She was a real Southern California girl. And I do believe that she is the one that started the trend of women wearing baseball hats, because she would grab one of Daddy's on the way out the door to the beach along with her big sunglasses. And she was really fun. Our beach days were the best. Huntington and Newport, Ruby's at the pier, and her famous beach sandwiches of pimento and cheese on sourdough and black and red licorice. Most importantly, though, my mother was a wonderful and incredible role model. She was truly a reverent woman, and I don't mean quiet by that, although she was quiet. I mean that she had Christ-like attributes. She was a good listener. She was modest. There was no coarse language. She always showed respect for others, and she was always on time, always early, really. She was so patient, and as Patrick said, she disciplined us with love. She'd take you in her arms, lick you in the eyes, and help you to understand the error of your ways or the poor choices you were making. And like Patrick, it was a knife in my heart. I just never wanted to make the same mistake and hurt her again. She was dependable and responsible and taught us to always be committed, to follow through, whether it was on our callings at church or just a promise to return a phone call. Be committed, be responsible. Honest in everything she did. Several times at the market, I'd be with her and they'd hand her too much change. She'd immediately hand it back. One time when we went home, she was unpacking the groceries, and there at the bottom of the sack was a mascara. I didn't buy this mascara. It must have belonged to the person before me, and they mistakenly put it in my bag. She took it right back. And in those days, I'm sure it was only worth a dollar or so. She took it back. I never ever heard my mother say, I want this. I need this. She, as Patrick said, was not a me, I person. It was all about everybody else. She was always filled with gratitude up to her very last days. She saw the beauty and the positivity in everything and in everybody. She exemplified the little saying, wherever you go, no matter the weather, always bring your own sunshine. She was my greatest cheerleader in my life. She had a sixth sense when it came to her family, especially the three of us. And she always knew just what we needed. And she was a master teacher. So many lessons learned as a child carry importance in my life today. And one of those was very simple. Be kind. In grammar school, I specifically remember her telling me never to speak unkindly about another person. Don't gossip. If my friends started talking or being unkind or mean, she told me that I should help redirect the conversation or their actions, or simply walk away and not be part of it. Treat others with kindness and don't be judgmental. Don't gossip. Well, she exemplified this all through her life, but one specific incident I remember is when she was serving in the Relief Society presidency of the Downey Third Ward. A woman was called to serve with them who wasn't particularly well-liked, and she was difficult to work with because of her negative attitude and her biting remarks. She would shoot out those pricklies instead of warm fuzzies. And it turns out my mom can work with anybody and truly find and bring out the good in them. And she did just that. She befriended this good sister and blessed this woman's life. And I learned from her, and I think I was pretty successful in grammar school, evident by every year, it seemed, my teachers would come to me and ask me to please share a desk or befriend another student that was being teased or ostracized or one that was just struggling. It was wonderful for me, because it expanded my groups of friendships. And I found that I could be friends with all kinds of people. When my brother Patrick is 12 years younger than I am, no children in between, and I adore this curly-haired, muscly little kid, but as a teenager, 12 years between us, I found his little antics of putting on his Zorro cape and his mask and wielding his sword, or putting on his football helmet and bringing the ball or his golf club, whatever it was that day, and he'd come charging into my room. I found all that just a little bothersome, and especially when I had friends over. So I would tell him, get out of my room, leave me alone, quit bugging me. Well, one day I came home from school, so vivid in my mind. My mother greeted me with her hug, but she also had the newly arrived church magazine, which back then was called The Improvement Air. And she handed it to me, and she said, I want you to read this particular article. It was entitled, If Only. It was a true story written by a young woman who had a little brother that would often bother her. And in summary, one morning before school, she yelled at him. She told him to get out of her room. She actually said, I hate you. Stay away from me. It drove him to tears. On her way home from school that day, as she was coming down her street, she noticed emergency vehicles in front of their home. And as she got closer, she saw her little brother's mangled bike laying on the lawn. He had succumbed to injuries from this accident. And all she could think about was go back to that morning If only she had treated her brother with love and kindness and not let words that now could not be taken back flow from her mouth. It was just a little story, but I wept, and I've never forgotten it. Did I ever treat you mean again? No. Never again. Well, I've never forgotten that story. And to this day, that's something I try really hard to never let words slip from my mouth that could injure another's heart. Words that cannot be taken back. Be kind. My mother knew how to approach and effectively teach important lessons and tools for life. Lessons on being more Christ-like. I miss my mother already. But every time I walk through the sands of the beach, or when I find a new seashell, I read a great historical novel, I make her Christmas cookies or English toffee, or when I will go to the nursery or plant a new plant or sing our beloved hymns, I know that I will feel her with me. My mother filled my days with rainbow lights, fairy tales, and sweet dream nights. Her kiss would wipe away my tears, and ice cream cones would ease my fears. She gave the gift of life to me, and then, in love, she set me free. I thank my mother for her tender care, for her deep, warm hugs, and for always being there. I hope that when my mother looks down on me, a part of her she'll always see. I love you, Mom. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Okay, so I'm introducing a song that Granny would sing called Sir, Have You Seen My Pony? And Grandpa tells me that we don't really know where it's from, but it's probably from my great-great-great-grandma, Alta Bixler. And I'm told that Granny sang this song 76 years ago as she rocked her first child, my grandpa, Michael, and she rocked and sang it to every subsequent child, grandchild, and many of us, the great-grandchildren. The video that we're going to play is recorded last month when she was 96. And to be frank, I don't remember this song. I was too young. But what I do remember was her awesome smile and her laugh. The glass orbs in her living room that everyone was afraid Chase and I would break all the time. I don't think we did. Maybe. And then I remember how much she loved to hear us play the piano or our instruments. The last time that we saw her, she was telling us how proud she was. All of us to see what we're doing and all the great things that are in store for us. And she said that she's so excited to see us when summer comes around to play in the pool. So maybe do a trick for her this summer in the pool, because I think she'd love that. Anyway, here's her song, Sir, Have You Seen My Pony?
send someone to me.
That's good, Bob.
My father got this phone. He will not be for a bike. I know he's somewhat lazy, but Barney is all right. He came from Shetland Island. My father told me so. He gave me my last birthday not many months ago.
I'd say you have a good memory to be able to remember that.
Yeah. Well, I probably sang it a lot.
That was mean to play that right before we have to talk. Gosh, I feel really grateful. She was my grandma. Chris asked us to put together some pictures for her, and as I scrolled through our pictures, I noticed a few things. The pictures were of either her and my grandpa, her holding a baby, or our family all together. When I think of my grandma, she is the feminine side of the ocean. My grandpa was the masculine side. She was the beauty. The beauty, the calmness, the peace, and of course the good snacks. Her favorite color was turquoise. So fitting for someone who loved the beach and who shared that love with us. When I think of my grandma, I think of walking in a room and seeing her smile. She really was so happy to always see me. Even though months and months would go by, she always greeted me with her tooth gap smile. I will carry on her love of candy making, list making, being barefoot, dry toast, puzzles, and game shows. I am grateful for the life she lived, the examples of both strength and meekness that she left me. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I am the luckiest to have had a grandmother like her. She loved me. She expressed her love for me every single time I saw her. She supported me. She truly made me feel like I could do anything, unless I cut my hair too short. And she didn't like that. And I've done it way too short. And I would walk in and she would say, "Oh, did you cut your hair? I can clearly remember her with my great-grandmother, her mom, saying, "Nobody's perfect like thee and me, honey." And she meant it, and I felt it. I knew that I was hers, that she loved me no matter what. She took me to Target for the first time. I will never forget walking through the aisles of Target in awe of this new store and her telling me all about it and telling my mom about this store called Target that was only in California, and we didn't have one in Utah, and it had the best stuff ever. Little did I know the therapy that Target would become. I talked her into buying me the glitter, the rubber bracelets that had glittery water inside of them. There was a group of them, and she said, "Laura, you really don't need those." And I was like, "I have to have them. I've never seen anything more beautiful in my life." And the glitter was so sparkly in there, and you could swish it around. And I remember at the checkout, she finally said, "Okay, I think I still have them." The water did go away in there, but the glitter is still there. The last time I spoke to her, I walked in and Jody was sitting there by her bedside. And as I walked in, she kind of looked at me a little bit puzzled. And I got closer to her bed and her face lit up. And she said, "Oh, that's Laura. I wasn't sure who you were until you smiled. I didn't recognize you. The minute I saw you smile, I knew that was Laura. That's Laura's smile." There is no better example of Christ-like love than my grandma. She embodied Christ-like love. She turned the other cheek, and she truly loved you with everything that she had. She loved you in the purest way. In 2006, she and my grandpa wrote their testimonies, and they gave them to each one of us with our Christmas gifts. And I'm going to read to you just a little bit of her testimony. "As you know, I am a convert to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. But for as long as I can remember, I have known that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. He is my Savior and yours. Through him, our prayers are heard and answered. I am so grateful to have been her granddaughter. I can see parts of me that I got from her. They're the good parts. I am grateful for my dad and my uncle and my aunt. I see so much of her in them. And I'm so grateful that they're a part of my life as well. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ, amen."
You'll notice that as we stand up, it's getting smarter and smarter as the siblings stand up. That stops with me. It kind of goes back down with Chris. But I remember my grandma's junk drawer. That is the memory I'd like to share with you today. That's an odd memory to have, but it would be this thing where we would pack up the car every summer, sometimes a couple times a summer, and we would go to Grandma and Grandpa's house in California on Raveler Drive. And we would jump out of the car, and there would be this race to the front door. And once we would get in, there would be this race. I still remember probably elbowing my sister Laura out of the way so I could get there first to the junk drawer. It was a drawer filled with stuff of all kinds, and it smelled like gum and Post-it notes and staples and paper and odds and ends. And I don't know how often she filled it up. I think that was just a place where all the junk went, hence the junk drawer. But I swear, to this day, I will always say that she filled that up just for us, and that she made sure that there was really fun, interesting stuff for all of us that kept our attention, that helped us have fun, that helped us be more playful, that helped us remember her. We all got to take stuff from the junk drawer. And I just think that that's very evident as we hear about our grandma, how much she provided for all of us, how much she made sure that we had what we needed in our lives. I can't imagine what it was like to be her son or her daughter and grow up with her every day, but I sure loved being her grandson. I love being her grandson. She was the one that kept, you know, my grandpa, as you've heard, and as you probably know, because I think you all knew him, he was loud, and he had his cowboy music, and there were so many stories that he got to tell, that he wanted to tell all the time, and he had a lot to say, and he had a lot of opinions that he always shared. And my grandma was so quiet, but she really kind of kept us centered and focused. My grandpa was in the Coast Guard, and if you look at the logo of the Coast Guard, there's two anchors. My grandpa was in the Coast Guard, but my grandma was the anchor. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I too enjoyed those trips to Downey. And when I would run to the front door, they were distracted by that junk drawer, but I wanted deviled eggs or cinnamon toast. Those were the things she made for me. And then I wanted to race over and see if Patrick was there because I wanted to play Cars. And the first thing I could do is get out this giant piece of vinyl that my grandma had drawn a city on. And she had drawn this beautiful city that was that we could drive the cars on. We could put little ramps. You know, Hot Wheels makes these kinds of things you can buy, but my grandma made this beautiful, this cool piece of vinyl. And Patrick was busy because he was older than me, so sometimes he couldn't play with me, but my grandma would get down on the floor and play Cars with me on this piece of vinyl. She loved to play. I think of my dad's career in designing things, and I think about that piece of vinyl that my grandma designed. Fun. She loved to play games. We played games with her. We played dominoes a lot in California with her. And we played cards. We played Uno. She taught me how to play gin. She and my other grandma taught me how to, shuffle and do the bridge thing. I'm teaching my kids how to do that. Even Everett knows how to do that now, thanks to grandma. A lot of fun. She was a lot of fun. I think as she passes on, she'll embrace her husband, and she will love the Savior and her parents and her sister and all of her aunts that she loved so much. And she will also work hard to meet Alex Trebek. He's there. We made a game for my grandma, actually for my grandfather, for his 95th birthday. I made a Name That Tune game. And I recorded, or I had a playlist with a bunch of old 60s and 50s and 40s cowboy songs. And I made these songs that my grandpa could hear and try to guess. So I had a list of all the artists on a piece of paper, on a big poster. And I think my aunt Deanne gave my grandma a little flashlight. So as I would play a song, here'd be the name of the, you know, it'd be Marty Robbins. My grandpa would hear it and he would be like, oh. My grandma would point the, she'd point the flashlight at Marty Robbins. And then Johnny Cash. and then Buck Owens. My grandpa didn't really remember any of these people, but my grandma knew every last one of them. And we talk about my grandpa being this big fan of country music, but quietly on the couch, my grandma was everything to him. In 1945, when my grandpa was serving in World War II, my grandmother was 19 years old, and she was pregnant. And she wanted to keep in touch with my grandpa, so she sent him a picture or two or three. One of those pictures in this little video that we showed today, and it's a picture of her pregnant, and she's, you can see a little belly bump. And on the back, she's written to my grandpa. And the top thing she says, first thing she says is, "This is the prize," with a big exclamation point. This is the prize. The prize is not to solve World War II. Certainly that was needed to get him home. The prize was my dad. The prize is all of you. The prize is us. We're the prize. I say that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Just so that you younger ones know, Patrick and Deanne, that junk drawer used to occupy our entire backyard. Until one day, Mom said to Dad, "You're going to clean up this stuff in the backyard." Dad had tile, and he was a contractor, and all kinds of stuff, and condense it down closer, closer, until it became the junk drawer. I never understood this till later years, I guess. My mom had heard this somewhere. She loved to play dominoes. And she would say, I don't think she was, well, I don't know. She would say it in a way that related to a previous religion, I guess. How many want to play dominoes? Kind of reminded me of my Catholic friends who, anyway. I'm 3.5 years older than Deanne, and Deanne would bring all of her cheerleader friends over to our house, and they'd like to hang around me, and I would find this a little bit bothersome. And eventually my mom said to me, "Mike, you're the oldest person. You're the oldest son or daughter. You need to not be like that. You need to welcome them into your room. You need to be you need to be kind to them. And if necessary, you need to help them with their cheerleading." And so when I was well, that's another story. I'll save that for another day. In the interest of time, I want to acknowledge the things that have been said already. Mom was kind. She wasn't so interested in things, like Chris said. The prize was in the people. In Doctrine and Covenants, it says, "Also they who receive this priesthood receive me, saith the Lord, For he that receiveth my servants receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth my Father. He that receiveth my Father receiveth my Father's kingdom. Therefore, all that my Father hath shall be given unto him, meaning them. Brothers and sisters, when we think of our inheritance from a loving father, an elder brother, do we think about worlds without number? Which I think, you know, they're baubles. Yeah, they're places where the important people live, but they're still just baubles. Are these the things that are the most precious, the most dear, and the most cherished treasures to our Heavenly Father? No. What is? It is us, His spiritual children. So what do we inherit when we obtain all that the Father hath? We get us. Through the temple, we're able to enjoy eternal relationships with our children, our parents, our brothers and our sisters, our aunts and our uncles, our families as a whole, and our friends. If those people have been good and true and tried their very best, I would visit with my mom in the last few weeks of her life, and it was hard to go. When the spirit and the body are put together, it's hard to break them apart. And my mom had a bit of a difficult time. I would say to her, Mom, do you want to talk about the other side? And she'd say, No, I'm not quite ready yet. And, well, what do you want to talk about, Mom? Well, I want to talk about Andrew, or Olivia, or Anna, or David and Poppy. I'm not ready to go yet. I would ask her if there was some fear that she would have, and she would say, No, are you kidding? I'm not afraid. And I would say, Well, what is it, Mom? And she would say, I'm not ready to say goodbye. So we never said goodbye. One morning, she simply left. The words of Bob Millett come to mind. He used to be our bishop, and he said, in essence, do you think that a father in heaven who has spent so much energy building that mountain out there, building those plants that you see, making the dog and the cat that we love, providing such a beautiful world, including his eldest son, giving him as a sacrifice. Do you think all of that would happen for nothing? No. I'm here to tell you there's a life after this one with a Father that loves us, our Father in heaven, with our elder brother Jesus Christ. And if we live worthily, we will have the chance to live with them again. I love you, Mother. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
to dismiss to the East Lawn Cemetery. I can tell everyone's invited to come, but we will then. I'm not sure who the pallbearers are, but those who are pallbearers, please come forward.
Everybody else can stand if you'd like and follow us into the.
Thank you.
where Claire's at. Thank you.